Coming up next in the lab is the steamer Natchez, built in 1975 by Louisiana Shipyard, along the lines of a turn-of-the-century steering wheel. The cluster of buildings we see behind the Natchez, the home of the old Jackson Brewery, which has just been completely renovated and reopened. There are about 60 specialty shops, 11 restaurants. It's best described as a combination music, arts, crafts, food, and shopping festival. New Orleans has long been known for its fabulous food and music, and the Jackson Brewery celebrates New Orleans heritage as never before. Coming up next is our first open view of a levee system that we have that protects the city of New Orleans from flooding by the Mississippi River. Our levees are maintained by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, Ernest E. Montalvo. No visit to New Orleans is complete without spending just a little time in this immediate area. You can browse through Jackson Square, where street artists from all over the world present many different views of America's most interesting city. Take a ride back through time, jump into one of the horse and buggies that go into the French Quarter. Might even pass the old blacksmith shop where the pirate Jean Lafitte and Andy Jackson planned the Battle of New Orleans. Go inside the cathedral, enjoy its quiet beauty. The State Museum is right next door, where on display you'll find the death mask of Napoleon. Also, this is where the Louisiana Purchase was signed. Do a little browsing around the brewery, maybe take a walk down Royal Street, which is Antique Row. Visit one of the many beautiful antique stores we have in the corner. Just an awful lot of activity going on in this immediate area, and we wouldn't want you to miss any of it. Now, if you're wondering what's the best way to get over here, you can catch the red trolley car back at the Hilton Hotel, and it will zip you over here in a matter of minutes. The long buildings you see running parallel to the levee are the French Market buildings. At first, we're passing as the oldest of the group, dating back to 1813. It's the home of the cafe. Been refurbished and put away in storage. They say it's going to take about a year to get the ship in tip-top shape, so hopefully your next visit to New Orleans will also include a visit to our newest attraction here on the mighty Mississippi and the Port of New Orleans, the Maritime Museum Cabot. Press Street Wharf, for now passing, was also a part of Mandeville's property. He had planned to build a cotton press plant here, but his plans never materialized. Though the street was named for it, that's a plan. We compressed the cotton bales to one-third their original size to make them easier to ship, handle, and of course take up less storage space. And just behind the lower end of Press Street Wharf, you'll see an old warehouse, one of the many victims of the great hurricane. Huge crane on board the Lash mothership stored on the ship and carried overseas. New Orleans is the birthplace of Lash. Because of that, we have more scheduled arrivals and departures of Lash ships and barges here than in any other port in the world. You look at the crane, they're picking up a barge now to be tracked to the stern of the ship to put it into the water. The barge facility we're passing next was completed in 1919, known as the New Orleans Army Terminal. It's been operated by the Army all these years, and its more proper name today is the Gulf Outport. Facility here has been a major port of embarkation for military cargo from the Second World War, Korea, Vietnam, and lately the Middle East. Now within the facility, we have a number of government agencies. As a unit of the Panama Canal Line Company, the government agency has the responsibility of servicing and supporting the Panama Canal Zone. As a unit of the Navy's military house. Coming up next on our left is the Stella Lykes. This vessel is owned by the number one shipping company in the United States, Lykes Brothers. They operate more than 48 vessels in the fleet. The main office is located here in the Port of New Orleans. This is not a cargo walked off and brought to this dock for minor repairs, Coast Guard inspections, and a fresh coat of primer and top coat paint. One another, okay? Now the ship carries 83 barges. Now in 48 hours they can take 83 barges off and put 83 barges back on for a total of 110,000 tons of cargo in 48 hours. What enables them to produce this fantastic amount of tonnage in so short a time is the 550-ton lifting capacity of the Lash crane. Now the ship is 890 feet long, it's 120 feet wide. The barges are 61 feet by 31 feet. And once again, Lash is the, well, New Orleans is the birthplace of Lash. Because of that, we have more scheduled arrivals and departures of Lash ships and barges here than any other port in the world. Now, I know a lot of you folks have come to this area are interested in either visiting or seeing old plantation homes. So if you point your cameras to your left in the direction of this group of lovelier homes of the Greek Revival style of architecture, we'll tell you all about Jackson Barracks. Jackson Barracks is headquarters for the Louisiana National Guard, commanded by Major General Anselm Stroud, Jr. Some of the original buildings constructed 150 years ago are still being occupied. Officers who early in their military careers were stationed at Jackson Barracks include Generals Robert E. Lee, Ulysses S. Grant, P.G.T. Beauregard, and C.B. McClellan. General Blackjack Pershing reviewed troops here during and after World War I. So point your cameras to your left, see if you can get a photograph or two of the old Jackson Barracks. One of Louisiana's guard units located here is the 141st Field Artillery, better known as the Washington Artillery, which has been in existence since 1838. The Washington Artillery has quite a proud history. Haven't seen action in the Mexican War, Civil War, Spanish-American War, World Wars I and II, and most recently in the Middle East. So point your cameras to your left, see if you can get a photograph or two of the old Jackson Barracks. Now, don't put your cameras away, because in very, very quick succession, we're showing you three more old plantation homes. Coming up next on the left is the old LeBeau Plantation House, one of the last great plantation houses found in the metropolitan area, completed in 1854 for Francois LeBeau. Now, this used to be an old sugarcane plantation. There was sugarcane planted here for as far as the eye can see, so it's no coincidence that we also have at this location one of the largest sugar refiners in the world, Amstar Domino Sugar. Now, the LeBeau House, here it is, coming up next on the left, was the main plantation home. And if you look at it very close, you can see they're putting a new roof on it. They are in the process of restoring this home, and hopefully, too, it's one-time state elegance. On top of the house is the freshly painted cupola, Widow's Walk. This is where the wives and sweethearts would go up every day to watch, walk, and wait for their men to return from the sea. Now, this is back in the days when ships were made of wood and men were made of steel. Sea voyages lasted months. Some took years to complete. Many times these men would not return from the sea, hence the name Widow's Walk. So point your cameras to your left and see if you can get a photograph or two of the old LeBeau Plantation home.